So guys, I don't think I ever told you the story about the sake-soaked speakers. It was in 2004. This is a real thing. I'm not making this up. In 2004, I went to a press event. It was like a one-on-one kind of thing, and it was for JVC, and they had these speakers. It was called the EXA1. I think I got the model correctly there, but I'm going to link to it directly below. Anyway, they had, it was a very formal, very Japanese style press event. And the main deal was that the speakers, the driver in the speaker in this particular example, was a full range driver, 3-inch full range driver, and it was made out of birch wood. And they went through great pains to make this driver and form it and make it light enough. And in order to do that, they had to soak it in sake. And we're like, what? And they were going on and on how this process, took 20 years to develop the right type of wood and the right type of sake. And they were drinking the sake. I'm drinking some right now. And actually, I think my glass needs a little refreshing. Thank you very much. And well, excuse me for a second. I don't really drink that much, but this is really good. So anyway, and by the way, at the press event, they were serving us the sake that they used to make this driver. And this Japanese gentleman, this engineer, was going on about his research and his evaluations, and he made these drivers because the whole point was that they used the sake to soften the wood, because without that, the wood would just splinter if they tried to form it into the shape of a cone that was thin enough and light enough. And he actually had all these examples laid out on a table of failed drivers that they formed okay when he was making them, but then, a year or two later, they split, on and on and on. It's kind of boring, but kind of funny all at the same time. So it was all part of like a little mini system. And it was more interesting than good. And if that's all there was to the story, I wouldn't probably be telling you the story. But oh, by the way, the cabinets for these speakers, these little speakers, were stunning. They were solid cherry wood cabinets. It's like a very Japanese style, very proper, very pure looking thing, but a mini system. So 2 years later, 2006, they developed a sake-soaked tweeter. So now they had a true two-way speaker, sake-soaked wood tweeter, dome tweeter, and a sake-soaked mid-range woofer driver. And again, we go back. Again, they're serving us warm sake in these thick mugs, much thicker and more like ceramic mugs than this. And it was incredible. That speaker was a little better, but it still wasn't, it was more, again, more interesting than good. By the way, you might have noticed I'm not home. I'm in a secret location somewhere in New York City, and it just feels good to do this one here. So anyway, also in 2006, Pioneer, I guess this is a totally unrelated event. They had this speaker, and I'm going to list the model names of these speakers directly below. But they had this speaker that looked more or less like an LS35A. But the cabinet for this speaker was made out of 50-year-old whiskey barrels. They also went through great pains to explain that they had built the exact same speaker out of a normal MDF cabinet, and it didn't sound as good as the whiskey barrel cabinet. So they brought out this speaker, and I was kind of interested in this one for real. So I said, please send them to me. They sent them to me, and we listened to them. This was at CNET, and everybody was blown away by this speaker, and it was $600. So $600, 13 years ago, it was an expensive speaker, but it was beautifully finished. The wood was stunning. The connectors, I remember the connectors were really, really high quality. Everything about it was first class. But when I went to write about it, I said, well, people have to be able to buy this speaker. And the thing was that you had to really, really look for it on the Pioneer site. They kept saying, well, it's not really for the American market. We don't think Americans would be all that interested in this thing. And I'm telling them, no, I'm really interested in it. I think you can sell these things here. So they kept, it went from being completely buried. They had to send me the link so I could find it in the first place. But But then they moved it more and more forward into the site, and they did sell. I don't know if they sold, you know, hundreds of them or thousands of them, but they did start to sell thanks to my writing about it on CNET. And I love that speaker, and I really regret not getting it then. I looked this morning on eBay and I found a pair that I think was $250, and I'm sort of going back and forth. I got a lot of speakers at home. Do I really want this speaker? I'm not sure. Maybe after I drink some more sake, I'll decide whether or not I'm going to buy that Pioneer. But my memories of it were, it wasn't just a gimmick that it was a whiskey barrel speaker. It was a really, really interesting speaker. Now, the other thing, in terms of, you know, the theme of this video, which I should have explained in the front, was the how alcohol affects music listening and your and pleasure. And actually, I can tell you, from when I was drinking more heavily than I do now, that I could listen to music that I, under normal circumstances, when I was sober, I didn't actually like. And when I was getting drunk, I liked it. I said, you know, it's funny how I like it now and I didn't like it before. So, you know, nowadays I'd be more likely to drink wine and listen. But again, I'm not a big drinker in general. But this sake is actually really good. So excuse me for 1 second. Nice. So a third example in terms of this merging of audio and music is, I can't remember when, 2015, I think. It was the 40th anniversary of Miles Davis' Bitches Brew album. A great record, truly a masterpiece. And Dog's Head Fish Beer, a craft brewery, I should say, they decided to make a Bitches Brew, a beer based on the idea of Miles Davis's Bitches Brew. So I'm going to show you a picture of that bottle, and they sent it to me, very nice, and I listened to Miles Davis, Bitches Brew, and I said to myself, and then wrote about, wait a minute, and now I can experience Bitches Brew with all 5 senses. I could always have listened to it. I could have always looked at the cover art. I could have always touched the cover, right? But now I can listen to Bitches Brew and taste it and smell it. So I have experienced Bitches Brew in all 5 senses. Now, of course, the only other person on the planet that did that before this brew was brewed was Miles Davis himself. I'm sure he probably did taste it as it was happening. He felt it. It was in his body. And then, thanks to Dogfish Head Beer Brewery, craft brewery, I was tasting it and smelling it as well. So, if you have any similar experiences of how the merging of alcohol and music, in live concerts, at home, with your hi-fi, making your hi-fi sound different and or better, hey, tell us all about it in the comments section directly below this video. Now, I'm not advocating getting drunk or high to enjoy music. I'm just saying it's a good side benefit. Oh, wait, I think I need to have my glass refreshed one more time. Thank you very much. So, yeah, so if you need this to make your music sound good, it's cheaper than most audio tools. You need a really good bottle of sake or wine or whatever. It's cheaper than most high-end audio products, so it's a better way to go. So anyway, thank you guys for watching. My name's Steve Guttenberg, coming to you from a secret location today in New York City. I will tell you, it's in New York City. I know this doesn't look like New York City. It's too clean and bright, right? But in fact, that's where I am. If you dig what I do, please subscribe to this YouTube channel, share these videos, give them thumbs up, blah, 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 blah. Follow me on Twitter at AudioPhiliacMan. And of course, Patreon, patreon.com/AudioPhiliac. Check that out. See you soon. Bye-bye.